Today we will talk about a new subject in our educational series, which is Art of Sonography. The new subject is Neonatal Spinal Ultrasound. Ultrasound can characterize nearly all spinal anomalies sufficiently, especially in the first days of life. This allows the clinical determination of whether the lesion requires urgent intervention or whether further radiologic evaluation with studies such as MRI is needed. To give a brief comment on the embryology of the spinal cord, to be able to understand the normal and the abnormal appearance of the spinal cord, the CNS starts to form during the third gestational week. It begins with the process known as neurulation. Next, canalization occurs at the distal end of the neural tube in the caudal cell mass. This results in an ependymema-lined neural tube that unites with the rest of the spinal cord to form the conus medullaris and ventriculus terminalis. In this diagram, we see this is the ectoderm with the future skin covering, and this is the neural plate border, and this is the neural plate. By process of folding, this will form a tube, a neural tube, and the edges of the neural plate border, or the border of the neural plate, will form what is called neural crest cells, and we will discuss later the derivatives of these cells, and the ectoderm will cover this region. To the which side of the neural tube, this is the mesoderm, will form, which will form the future vertebral column, and this is the notochord, which will form the gut. The cells of the neural tube migrate to form the mantle layer or the gray matter. They are differentiated into the alar plate, which is mostly sensory neurons, and the basal plate, which is mostly motor neurons. They are marked by the sulcus limitans. The cells of the mantle layer, which have axons, collect into the marginal layer to form the white matter. This is the white matter, and this is the gray matter. Meninges are formed by the neural crest cells, in which the dura mater is the external layer, and the bioarachnoid are separated by the arachnoid trabeculae. Other derivatives of the neural crest cells are ganglion cells, melanocytes, and the mesenchyme of the pharyngeal arches, Schwann cells, and the suprarenal medulla cells. Coming to the technique of ultrasound examination of the neonatal spinal cord, to start with the indications of neonatal spinal ultrasound is the posterior midline cyst or masses, midline skin dimple, tuft of hair, visible hemangioma or skin discoloration, other congenital anomalies such as anal atresia or stenosis, which is may be associated with spinal cord anomalies. Also, ultrasound is indicated for guidance of lumbar puncture and post injury or trauma to the spinal cord, post surgical for follow-up of complication, and in cases of infection or abscess formation. Limitation of neonatal spinal ultrasound. Caution needs to be taken with open or near open neural tube defects. Sterile technique should be followed, ideally with a sterile gel standoff and minimal pressure, or sterile water or saline may be appropriate rather than gel, and the MRI is the modality of choice for open neural tube defects. The room and equipment preparation. High frequency linear array transducer of minimum of 8 MHz frequency is needed, warm water, warm gel, warm hands, and dim lighting. Bribery, assuming parent for or assistant, or food pacifier dummy or glucose syrup can be used to tip the pacifier or a maternal finger in to encourage quiet suckling. Patient position, prone with head slightly higher than the feet to better fill the lower CSF space, a rolled towel or something similar to that under the baby's abdomen to slightly widen the posterior interspinous spaces. Scanning technique, we start with survey followed by detailed examination. This survey will take only 1 to 2 minutes, but it is important. First, in transverse, sweep between the mid-thoracic region to and the sacrococcygeal region. Next, in a sagittal plane, sweep from one side to the other side. The aim of the survey is to answer two questions. The first is, are the posterior neural arches bared and uniform? And second one, is there any obvious growth pathologies? And this is an example of normal axial anatomy by survey. Starting from the mid-thoracic region and getting downwards till the sacrococcygeal region. A rapid technique, just a survey. And this is another example of the sagittal technique for the survey. From one side to the other side. Then we come to the detailed scan. Our aim is to answer six questions by the detailed scan. The first of them is the cord and CSF space are uniform in shape? Follow the cord along in transverse plane, assessing the shape and central position. Any variation in position or shape of the cord is suggestive of mass effect, and searching for the cause is needed. Similarly, the CSF space should be uniform. The second question is, where is the conus? There are two primary methods to determine the level of the conus. The first is to identify the lumbosacral junction and count up from L5, and second one is to identify the 12th rib and thus T2 vertebra and count down. T12 vertebra and count down. To identify the lumbosacral junction, this is the LS image of the ultrasound, the lordotic angle between the lumbar and sacral vertebra. This is the arrow, this is L5, and this is the lumbar vertebra and this is sacral vertebra. So this is the lumbosacral junction, and this is the L5 vertebra to count for the level of the conus. Another example of LS, this is the L5, this is the angle between the lumbar vertebrae and the sacral vertebrae, and this is to count, this is the conus is at L2 vertebra. If the level cannot be accurately determined, a radio-opaque marker may be fixed to the skin over the conus, and a plane X-ray may be performed. Normal conus position is no lower than the top of L3 vertebra in a term infant or the bottom of L3 vertebra in a preterm infant. Normal conus medullaris at L2 vertebra. This is the red arrow. This is the conus medullaris. This is L2 vertebra. And this is the normal position of the conus. The third question is to identify the phylum terminale. It should appear as thin, closely related parallel lines extending from the conus to approximately S2 vertebra. Phylum is approximately 1 to 2 millimeter in diameter, not more than that. And this is the appearance of the phylum. This is the conus. As a phylum extended from the conus, we can follow it downward to S2 vertebra. This is the normal phylum terminale. The fourth one is examine the cauda equina. The nerve root comprising cauda equina should lie in the dependent portion of the cecal sac, should see gentle oscillating movements with the baby's cardiac pulsations and respiration. Look for asymmetry indicative of pathology, either space occupying mass or unilateral abnormalities. And this is the normal appearance by LS. This is in the dependent part of the spinal canal. This is the cauda equina, and this is the TS. This is also the cauda equina. To see the oscillatory movement with cardiac pulsations and respiratory movement, I think it is very clear in this video. The fifth one is examine the bony anatomy. Particular attention should be paid to the integrity of the posterior neural arches in both transverse and sagittal planes. Check the vertebral bodies for alignment, shape, and symmetry in both transverse and sagittal planes. This is the lamina of the vertebrae. This is the nerve root. Anteriorly is the vertebral blade, vertebral bodies, sorry. Also in LS, this is the posterior neural arches, and this is the vertebral bodies anteriorly. Also, this is the vertebral transverse process, the dura mater, and this is the vertebral body anteriorly. This is TS image, ultrasound image. The normal cortex is composed of hypoechoic cartilage and usually has a kyphotic shape. This is the cortex, hypoechoic, because it is formed of cartilage at this age and has a mild kyphotic curve. This is by LS examination. The sixth question and the last one is examine the dambyl skin defect or mass, if present, of course. If there is a dambyl skin defect or mass, this should be carefully examined with a high frequency probe to look for a skin cetal sac fistula. Use minimal pressure so as not to compress and thus obscure a fistula stretch. If CSF is leaking, an MRI should be performed. It's better to do MRI in case of CSF leakage. To summarize, we do survey, rapid survey in axial and sagittal planes, then detailed examination to answer these six questions. Is the chord and CSF space uniform in shape? Where is the conus? Identify the phylum terminal, examine the chorda equina, examine the bony anatomy, and examine the dambyl skin defect or mass if present. We should know there is some variance, in normal variance in the appearance, should not be misdiagnosed as pathology. What are these variants? The first of them is ventricular terminalis, often seen in children younger than 5 years old, is due to incomplete fetal regression of the embryonic terminal ventricle in the conus medullaris. Size smaller than 5 millimeters and stability over time distinguish this normal variant from small series. And this is by longitudinal ultrasound, mild dilatation of the terminal part of the central canal of the spinal cord. This is by ultrasound, and this is by MRI, sagittal T2 MRI. Size less than 5 millimeters and stability over time. Filar cyst. Possible explanations for its origin are that the normal arachnoid reflections form a pseudocyst-like structure, or that it is a true empyema-line cystic embryonic remnant. It is a normal variant that alone has no clinical significance and that does not require additional imaging. Its ultrasound characters include midline location within the phylum just below the conus, well-defined fusiform in shape, hypoechoic appearance of a simple cyst. And this is an example of a filar cyst. This is LS ultrasound examination, and this is a TS. This is the cyst just below the coda equina, conus medullaris. This is the conus medullaris. This is the filar cyst outside the conus medullaris to differentiate it from the ventricular terminalis. And this is by TS. Another example, this is a filar cyst, and this is the conus medullaris. And this is the central spinal canal. Prominent phylum terminal. A prominent phylum terminal may cause concern when it stands out as particularly echogenic in comparison with other nerve roots. It is distinguished as normal by its thickness, should be less than 2 millimeters, and typical midline course. This is a prominent phylum terminal, but still within the normal range, being less than 2 millimeters in diameter. And this is a prominent phylum terminal by LS ultrasound examination. Another normal variant is the pseudomass due to positional nerve root clumping. Positional clumping of the nerve roots occur when an infant is scanned in the decubitus position, either right or left lateral decubitus positions. Rescanning the child in prone position will cause the mass to disappear as the nerve roots return to their normal position. This is an example of a pseudomass appearance this is a TS and LS due to clumping of nerve root due to decubitus position. And this is by LS, this is TS. This can be distinguished as normal by changing the patient position into prone position. Another one is the pseudosinus tract is seen on ultrasound as a cord-like hypoechoic lesion composed of fibrous tissue extending from the skin dermal to the coccyx. True dermal sinus tracts rarely occur at the tip of the coccyx and are typically found in a more cranial location. Careful search should be made for any mass or fluid along the course of the fibrous tract. If CSF is draining via a dermal, a true sinus tract is likely. Whatever the location, either cranially or caudally, if there is a CSF draining via this dermal, it is a true sinus tract. This is an example. This is the tip of the coccyx, this is the arrowhead, the LS ultrasound examination, and this is the cord-like pseudo tract, pseudosinus tract. This is the pseudosinus tract, and this is the tip of the coccyx, and this is the skin dermal here. Another normal variant is dysmorphic coccyx. The tip of the coccyx can vary widely in shape and may mimic a mass by physical examination. This is an example of LS ultrasound examination. This is the coccyx, is hypoechoic cartilaginous tip was acutely angulated dorsally as it extends towards the skin surface, causing a bulbable mass. Another example, also the direction of the tip of the coccyx towards the skin surface, causing a bulbable mass on physical examination. This is a straight coccyx with loss of normal kyphotic curvature. Another variant. Coming to the pathology, tethered cord is a pathological fixation of the spinal cord in an abnormal caudal location so that the cord suffers mechanical stretching, distortion, and ischemia with growth and development. Signs associated with a tethered cord: low conus below the level of L2, as we mentioned before, thickened or tight phylum terminal, lipoma in the spinal column, dermal sinus tract, diastematomyelia or split spinal cord, restricted movement of the nerve strands. Of course, not all these signs will be present in each case. This is an example of longitudinal ultrasound examination of 3 days old neonate. Conus is at L5. And the by TS, this is a thick phylum exceeding 2 millimeter in diameter. This is the thick phylum terminal. Hydromyelia is the abnormal widening of the central canal by cerebrospinal fluid. This condition may be either focal or diffuse, may extend through the entire length of the spinal cord. It can be associated with several congenital abnormalities, including diastematomyelia, Arnold Chiari malformation, myelomeningocele, and leptomeningocele. If there is a fluid collection in the cord outside the central canal, it is called syringomyelia. Because it is often not possible to separate these two entities on imaging, it is better to use the term syringohydromyelia to describe the condition. Transverse image will show the transition of the normal cord into the cord which surrounds a CSF collection. And this is an example. This is the normal central spinal canal, very narrow. Then it becomes widened in a focal form of hydromyelia. There is associated dermal sinus tract here, and this is a TS showing the spinal cord surrounding a collection of CSF. It is this at this level, TS examination at the B level, and this is the dilated central spinal canal and the surrounding spinal cord. Another example, this is the normal spinal canal, then become widened, then it is obviously widened, and this is by sagittal T2 MRI examination. The cord is tethered, ending at L5 vertebra. Spinal lipoma is an encapsulated deposit of fat, neural tissue, meninges or fibrous tissue, which extends from the posterior subcutaneous tissue through the midline defect of the fascia, muscles, or bone to communicate with the spinal canal or meninges. A spinal lipoma is seen as an echogenic mass, mostly in the lower spinal canal. The conus can be too low and buried in the lipoma. This is an example of LS examination, ultrasound examination. This is the conus at L2 at its normal position, yet it is buried within a spinal lipoma and there is associated thick phylum terminale. This is the lipoma, this is second phylum terminale, and this is the conus middle layers. Another example, this is the lipoma. The cord ends at S1, denoting tethered cord, and there is mild hydromyelia, mild dilatation of the central spinal canal. Another example, this is the spinal lipoma, and the cord is tethered. Dorsal dermal sinus. This is a connection between the skin and the dural sac, sometimes into the spinal cord. It presents with a dimple, discoloration of the skin, or hairy patches. The conus medullaris can be tethered. This is an example of transverse ultrasound examination of a 3-day-old girl with a red stain on the lower back, a tuft of hair, and a dimple. This is the dorsal dermal sinus extending into the spinal canal, to the skin, connecting the skin to the spinal canal, denoted by the red arrow. This is in cine images. I think this is obvious. The stomatomyelia, it is also named split cord malformation. It is a longitudinal split of the spinal cord. At the point of division, there may be an osseous, fibrous, or cartilaginous dividing septum. The stomatomyelia is commonly associated with a vertebral column abnormality and a tethered spinal cord. The ultrasound diagnosis is usually straightforward. In this TS ultrasound image, there is two spinal cords divided, asymmetrical division. This one is larger than the other, and this is the image by MRI, T1 weighted MRI axial image. Another example, but with symmetrical division of the spinal cord into two spinal cords, denoting the stomatomyelia. Blunt cord terminus. The cord ends at the normal position but is deformed. There is generally a wedge-shaped ending in which the dorsal side reaches further caudally than the ventral side. As you see, this, the shape of the lower end of the cord of the conus medullaris is deformed. This is the extension of the dorsal aspect more than the ventral aspect. This is associated with caudary Richter syndrome, with absent distal sacrum below S4 is absent, and this is by ultrasound below S4 vertebra. There is no vertebrae, and the cortex also is absent. Another example of blunt cord terminus. This is the termination of the cord, abnormal shape. Subdural spinal hematoma is uncommon in neonates, but it may be iatrogenic after attempts for lumbar puncture. Ultrasound is useful to determine whether the cecal sac is compressed by the hematoma or not. Then example, LS and TS images, ultrasound images. This is echogenic blood collection separating the dura mater from the posterior vertebral arch, posterior neural arch, and surrounding the spinal cord in TS images. This echogenic collection is blood, and this is in LS. Infantile hemangiomas over the skin on the center lower back and buttock area carry a risk for being associated with a spinal cord problem, the most common being an intraspinal lipoma with tethered cord. Then example of transverse gray scale and color Doppler ultrasound of 3 days neonate, superficial hemangioma in the skin by sickening in B mode ultrasound, and by color Doppler there is increased vascularity, but without intra spinal extension, without intraspinal component. It is just a superficial hemangioma of the skin. Open spinal dysraphism, meningocele, myelomeningocele, and myelocele are included in the open spinal dysraphism group. These lesions are not skin covered. Myelomeningocele constitute more than 98% of the open spinal dysraphism cases. In myelomeningocele, an expansion of the ventral subarachnoid space displaces the neural blackcoat dorsally, resulted in portions of the spinal cord, nerve roots, and leptomeninges lined within the sac. However, in myelocele, the neural blackcoat remains fused flush with the skin surface, and there is no expansion of ventral CSF space. This is an example of myelomeningocele. This is a TS, L, and LS ultrasound images, and this is the sagittal T2 MRI image of 2 weeks newborn. The red arrow denotes the herniated conus medullaris here and here, and the yellow asterisks denoting the dilated ventral CSF space, and this is the herniated conus on MRI and the dilated ventral CSF space. Another example, LS and TS ultrasound of a 1 week newborn. This is the herniated conus, and this is a dilated ventral CSF space, also in this TS image. The take-home message: proper technique of examination is essential. Good knowledge of the normal anatomy and normal variance is helpful. Be systematic and look for all findings, because there is multiple associations. Advice about further steps in management plan, especially radiological ones. Thank you. And please don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. Thank you again. Goodbye.